Hello, everyone. Merry Christmas. I am going to be re-recording tonight the Nativity, what we got wrong and what we get right, so that you can see maybe what the real Nativity more likely look like than what we picture in our heads. I think historical accuracy is fun and interesting, and I think it really changes how you view the incarnation of Christ. It really does change it a little bit. So I wanted to record this with my notes and have, you know, a one-on-one face-to-face with you and just talk about it a little bit more in depth. So let's get started. What we get wrong and what we get right about the Nativity. So I've got lots of pictures for you. We're going to talk about that whole no room in the inn thing, what Bethlehem, the significance of Bethlehem was, what the manger was, what Israelite homes at the time looked like, and then what the most likely scenario was, and then some other possibilities, and then we're going to talk about what's the point. We're about 5 or 6 BC most likely, because we know that Herod the Great died at 4 BC, so it had to be before that. And Bethlehem is where they are located after walking from Nazareth. They may have had a donkey, but not very likely, because we do know they were exceedingly poor given the sacrifice they made when they took Jesus to the temple. So we've got Mary and Joseph and the baby Jesus. We're talking about the Nativity, and we are going to talk about why at the end. So here is our typical Nativity scene. And so I want you to look at this and say, is this accurate? What could be wrong with our typical Nativity scene? Well, first of all, we've got three kings on the right, the three magi that look like kings. We know they weren't kings. They were wise men. They were king makers, but they would not have been wearing a king's crown. They would not have been at the birth of Jesus. They were later. They came later. We've got an angel nailed to the top there with wings, a feminine angel with beautiful flowing gowns and wings. And we know angels didn't look like that. Angels were mighty warriors. They were frightening and they didn't have wings. The only ones that had wings did not look like that. So that's not what an angel looked like. We've got kind of a barn situation going, what we typically think of as a barn. This barn looks a little bit more like an ancient house as opposed to what we typically have, but I did want to show it to you. You've got some anachronistic styling there with the hats being kind of strange, the animals and the manger. Look at the manger. It's this little basket looking thing that we typically see. So think about how you normally visualize the Nativity scene in your mind, and we're going to talk about what it more likely looked like. And so what I did on Sunday is I said the first person to find the quote in the Bible where the innkeeper tells Joseph and Mary that there's no room in the inn. And a few of them were really intensely looking because they thought they remembered it, but it's not there. There is no innkeeper because there is no inn. And we'll talk about that as well. These are things that were added as part of tradition, and we kind of just accept them without looking to scripture to see if it's actually true or not. So it's not there, obviously. There is no innkeeper, and there's not a mention of a commercial inn either. So let's talk about what we know. This is where I pull out the notes and we get a little nitty gritty here. So hang on one quick second. Let's get this situated. We got this one here. We've got tight here. Let's make this smaller, make this one bigger. This will go on the right. All right, we're good. All right. So, customs of receiving guests. Hospitality in that culture was and is vital. You've got kind of this nomadic culture where people would, when you traveled, you didn't have hotels to stay in. And even if you did have some commercial inn in places, people really didn't utilize that. It was very expensive. You know, most of these people are very poor. Mary and Joseph were definitely poor. And there was no inn in this situation. So people relied on the hospitality of strangers. And it became so important culturally that if you became known as inhospitable, it was shameful. And remember, this is honor and shame. This is an honor-shame culture. So it would be shameful to not be hospitable. Hospitality was vital. So we know that that was very important. It still is in the Middle East, very important. We know that guests received the best. They were honored. They were cared for. And your reputation as being hospitable was vital. We also know that Joseph had a hometown connection to Bethlehem. He was descended from King David. This was David's hometown. So he had a connection to this town. An extended family was very much important in this culture, even if they'd never seen you before. If you come in and say, I'm so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, they know who you are, they know you're related, and immediately your family space would have been made, is my point. They would have made space for Mary and Joseph. The Mosaic Law, remember, called for family land to be perpetually inherited. And Bethlehem was in the tribe of Judah's inheritance. So even after the Babylonian captivity, people would have come back and associated that land with the descendants of the tribe of Judah. Boaz, King David's great-grandfather, lived there. David could even have been born in that house. This ancestral house could still have been there, or at least an ancestral house for this descendancy. Now, Joseph was a descendant of King David. And so that was very important. He was of the kingly line. And this being David's hometown, he would have been greeted and received very hospitably, very warmly welcomed because of this link, if nothing else. So when he shows up with a very pregnant wife saying, I am Joseph, son of Jacob, the son of Mathan, the son of Eleazar, they would have very likely made any space they could have for him. And ancient customs alone would have been sufficient for lodging, but especially one of the royal line of David. And then we take into account Mary's pregnancy. She is giving birth. She knows something's moving and shaking, and childbirth was given very special attention. People were not isolated like they are today. There was this sense of family and community. You lived in community. You lived in communal spaces. This sense of privacy and having my own space wasn't really a thing. So people banded together and they took care of each other and came together, especially for something like childbirth. Women would have gathered around Mary and been with her and helped her and been there for her in a way that we typically don't do nowadays. It would have been a community event, giving birth. Other women would have assisted. And regardless of circumstances, there's no way they would have left a woman given birth on her own with nowhere to go. They would have made sure she was taken care of. So this changes things a little, doesn't it? This slide is showing Bethlehem, the location where it is. And I want you to notice how close Bethlehem and Jerusalem are. That's important for the storyline. And also notice how far away Nazareth is. But just to the left of Bethlehem and Jerusalem, there's some hill country there. And that's where Mary's relatives lived. You had Elizabeth and Zechariah. Remember, she had just been there. She had stayed with them in the early part of her pregnancy, just 6 months earlier. And so the tradition says that they lived in a small village in the hills west of Jerusalem called Ein Kerem. And so if for some reason they really were not able to accommodate Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem, they could have easily gone to stay with Elizabeth and Zechariah. Some believe that they did. So that is something to keep in mind as well. Now, I want you to look at this map. This is a very geographically topographical map, and I want you to notice how Bethlehem is on the edge of a ridge. There's a mountain ridge there. So they're overlooking kind of a valley, and Bethlehem's on the edge there. So that is important for what we're going to talk about. Just a visual map of Bethlehem, which was larger than it is today. These are the roads. I'm going to talk about that here in just a second. This is the Way of the Patriarchs. All right. Hang on. Let me make this bigger. All right. So the Way of the Patriarchs was an ancient road that went from Beersheba in the south all the way up to Shechem. And the road they built first. They would build the road on the most level ground. And then these little towns would pop up along the road. It's not like they were trying to connect towns. The towns build up around the road. On the left, you've got the Via Maris in purple. And on the right, in the red, you've got the King's Highway. And then there's this middle road that would not have been as easily traveled if you're just going like from Egypt to Damascus. You probably wouldn't have taken this route. You would have taken the Via Maris or the King's Highway. But if you're traveling within Israel and you're going from Nazareth to Jerusalem or Bethlehem, you would have taken the Way of the Patriarchs.
patriarchs. And so this town, this road, I mean, passes through Hebron, Bethlehem, Jerusalem, Bethel, Shiloh, and Shechem. And you'll notice that they say you're going up to Jerusalem or you're going up to Bethlehem. That's because topographically, it was a higher elevation. You went uphill to get to Jerusalem and Bethlehem versus north-south. They were talking about topographically up and down versus north and south. Okay, let's talk about the Migdal Eder. This is such a cool concept. This is a watchtower, the watchtower of David. Let me flip so we can see, because you can't really see it in those slides. It never translates well from PowerPoint. Okay, so this is the Tower of the Flock, or the Watchtower of the Flock. It was a military tower. Remember how Bethlehem's on a ridge on the north end of the town, in the area of the fields? It would have had this watchtower where you could look over and you could watch and see if bad guys were approaching, if you were being invaded. You could look for predators, like, you know, animals. You're out there with your sheep. You could watch for wolves and things like that. It's traditionally about a mile north of Bethlehem and 4 miles from Jerusalem. It was within the city limits of Bethlehem in the old days. It's mentioned in Rachel's account in Genesis 35:21. And the shepherds would use this tower. They would use the Migdal Eder as a place for protection if they needed to. If you know, there were armies marching through or something, they could go there for protection. They could go there for protection from wild animals. And this is where they would birth their lambs. Now, these shepherds around Jerusalem and between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, they were not normal shepherds. They were shepherds that were consecrated to raise the temple sacrifices. And so when their lambs gave birth, they would swaddle those lambs so that they didn't become injured, because you needed a blemish-free lamb for sacrifice. And they would bring the ewes into the Migdal Eder tower to give birth, or if they had sick sheep, they would bring them in for protection. But typically, you know, the sheep stayed outside otherwise. But that's what they would use the tower for. And it was well known. It was between these fields between— here's where I talk about that. The Talmud talks about how the cattle in the area around Jerusalem were deemed holy and only usable for temple sacrifices. And these shepherds would have been specially trained in how to do that. Specifically, these were used for peace and Passover sacrifices specifically. Remember the Passover lamb? And they were in this consecrated circle around Jerusalem. Now notice that, remember, the shepherds were the first ones to hear the good news. They were the first ones to hear about the Messiah. And these weren't ordinary shepherds. These were shepherds of the temple sacrifice, which is so important because Christ was our final sacrificial lamb, right? And something interesting is Micah 4:8, plus the Midrash, the stories around it, the tradition involves this first declaration involving the Messiah being born at Migdal Eder. Some think that Mary and Joseph could not find a place to stay in Bethlehem, so they stayed in the Migdal Eder tower. And that's why the shepherds knew where to look. A baby in swaddling clothes, they knew exactly where to look. There's a lot of tradition around the Migdal Eder, and that is a possibility. It absolutely is. So some say that that's where Christ was born. So I think that's fascinating, right? But when we hear the word manger, we picture a barn, a traditional Western barn, right? The Hebrew word ibus and the Greek phatne words for manger come from the verbs for to feed or to eat. So you've got a domesticated animal's feeding trough. That's what it means. And these were commonly found inside homes in Bethlehem. These would have been in the towns, the common homes. We're going to look at what they looked like. So at night, they would have these a few animals at most that were very valuable. They were their work animals. These were vital for their survival. These are their investments. And so they would bring them in at night for protection, bring them into the bottom story of their home where they would have feeding troughs, and they would have a place to tie them up for the night, and then they would let them back out in the morning. They wouldn't leave them outside to be stolen or injured or run off or whatever. They would bring them in for the night. And they have found stone carved or plaster or stone built. They found these stone mangers inside homes on the first level. And the reason we think that this is the more likely location versus anything else, is one reason we think so is the words that they use for there was no room for them at the inn, right? We do have that word inn. So what do they mean? Well, Luke is writing this, and so we can look at Luke's other words and see which one it's associated with. The word for commercial inn is pendocheion, and that's not used. That's the word for commercial inn, like in the story of the Good Samaritan, right? Where he takes him to a commercial inn, leaves money for the innkeeper to take care of him and says, I'll come back if there's any more expenses. It's a commercial inn. And that's not the word used in the birth story here, the nativity story. The word used is a word for guest room. It's the word cataluma. And they have found excavated homes, specifically one at Kerbet El Makatir, 9 miles north of Jerusalem. I've read this guy's archaeological reports. It's fascinating. I've got links to it in the references slide. And what they found is this interior wall. They would have this area set up in their downstairs that would have pillars. And in between the pillars, they would set out these little, they would have carved in places for troughs for the animals overnight to have a place to eat. And so the upstairs room, let me just show you. So here are some pictures of what the homes might have looked like. And so I want you to look at this top left home for to begin with, okay? This top left home that's kind of gray. You have these two rooms at the top, one of which would have been a guest room and one of which would have been where they slept, where they stayed overnight, where the family did. Now, downstairs is where they spent their days. And you typically have this courtyard in the middle. And this is where you spent your day. You're doing your work. Day-to-day stuff happened. Their kitchen and everything would have been downstairs. And look on the second picture in the middle. The staircases were typically on the outside of the homes. They were flat-topped. And if it was a beautiful day outside, you could go on the roof and stay up there. You could sleep there overnight. There would have been room there. You could have stayed overnight if it wasn't raining. Now look on this far right picture. You see these pillars. This is the downstairs and these pillars, and there would have been on one side at least kind of a, you know, lower level cutout there where they would have had the mangers, the troughs, not mangers, they would have had the troughs for the animals to eat out of overnight. And the animals would have been kept in that area overnight. And that is where we think most likely Mary had her baby. Now, was it ideal? No. Was it in the nice guest room upstairs? No, that was full. There might have been Roman soldiers there. There might have been Israelite leaders there all dealing with the census. Or could have just been full from people who came before them. But would they have kicked them out on the street? Probably not. They would have made room for them somewhere. And it's not ideal to sleep where the animals are, to give birth where the animals are kept, but they would have cleaned it out for her. They would have made it as nice as possible. And, you know, the women would have come around her and helped her. And it's just, it's a different way of viewing how this would have worked. Let's look at some more homes. This one is really cool. You can see on the bottom there where the animals would have stayed. And if you look kind of to the side, you can see the cutouts where the troughs would have been. And that's where we think Jesus would have been laid, in a nice, clean, soft trough. Here's a cutout version where you can kind of see the indoor stable kind of thing where the animals would have been with their little troughs. I just think this is fascinating. So that's most likely where she was. She wasn't in some outdoor barn. She wasn't left alone out to suffer. It was suffering, obviously giving birth. And she would have been scared, and it wasn't ideal. It wasn't terribly comfortable, but she wasn't alone. She wasn't outside. You know, I just think that makes such a difference. Here's another picture of a first century Israelite house. If you look kind of behind the sheep on the bottom floor, you can kind of see the cutouts in the wall, how that worked. And you see how upstairs is where they would have lived. They would have slept, but downstairs is where their kitchen was and where they went about their day-to-day business. And so upstairs would have been the ideal place, but it was full. And so she just didn't have that option, but she had the downstairs. And honestly, if you're giving birth, you know, and it's, I don't know, it may not have been that bad. Honestly, I mean, giving birth is terrible, but here's some other pictures of the fenestrated windows downstairs. I call them fenestrated windows because they kind of look like windows when they've got the troughs at the bottom. Here's another example just to kind of see the outside of the home, how the stairs would have been kind of on the outside. Okay. So rooms were typically located around a central courtyard with a water cistern. They would live upstairs. Their guest room would have been upstairs. And the ground floor rooms were for storage, daily household activities, and those domestic stables behind this fenestrated wall. You can kind of see the wall there, the little fenestrations where the poles would have been, the pillars, and then between would have been the troughs. There's another way to see it. I just think this is so neat. It totally changes how I see the nativity, right? So the most likely scenario overall is that Mary and Joseph went to Joseph's hometown, his town of origin, and went to his ancestral home and found out that the second floor guest room's already full. But being hospitable and with Mary giving birth and with Joseph being descended from the line of David, they would have done everything they could to help her. They would have. They would not have left her out on her own, most likely. So most likely, Mary gave birth to Jesus on the ground floor of that home, and Mary placed Jesus in the manger of the home's domestic stable. Isn't that neat? I just think that's so cool. Now, some other possibilities are the Migdal Eder. They could have stopped there and given birth there, which would have been very significant given the Micah prophecies and the shepherds and everything. That's a possibility. We have to keep that in the realm of possibilities. There's also this building called a caravanary. It's really the only public building Bethlehem would have had. And if you've got this big caravan and you're moving through town, what they would have done is put all their valuables on the inside and their animals on the inside, and then they would have all slept on the outside, kind of protecting it in this kind of ramshackle over pavilion kind of deal. That's a possibility. But again, she would have had community. She would have been surrounded by people. And I'm not sure there would have been a trough there, a manger for her to lay him in. So that's not as likely in my opinion, but it is possible. And I'm always going to tell you when we're not sure of things. So the guest room upstairs was possibly full of Romans, Jewish leaders running the census, other travelers who had just gotten there first. But likely with the community and the way that that culture worked, most likely they would have brought her in, made room for her wherever they could. Remember, the town is swollen with people. It's normally like 400 people. And I mean, you've got thousands and thousands of people coming in for the census. So they would have fit her in wherever they possibly could. It's a slim possibility that she was on her own somewhere. But it's just not as likely in my opinion. Now, another alternative we have to consider are caves. There are shallow caves into that rock area. We saw how Bethlehem is on this ridge. There are caves all over the place where people traveling could have stopped. I've not done any archaeological digs, but they found dig outs for poles to hold for animals overnight. And they've found where they've dug out troughs in these caves. And when rebellions and things happen and invasions, people would flee to the mountains, to these caves for safety. And so it is possible she was in a cave. And actually Constantine's mother believed that it was one of two or couple of the caves where she most likely gave birth in Bethlehem and built the Church of the Nativity on top of those caves. So that's a distinct possibility because that was, you know, in the 300s AD, which, you know, would have been far closer to, you know, it's possible that tradition had carried on where she gave birth. It's possible. But again, given what we've seen in these homes and knowing the culture of hospitality, and knowing that these homes actually had troughs and stables inside their homes, that's the far more likely option in my opinion. So what's the point? Why are we even talking about this? As cool as it is, does it make a difference? Well, when we're talking in the long run, not really. But when you're picturing the nativity and when you're celebrating Christmas, I want you, instead of picturing Jesus being born into this lonely, sad, isolated barn moment, instead, I want you to picture him surrounded by family, extended family staying in that home who would have rushed to help Mary, especially the women. She didn't give birth very likely alone.
She very likely gave birth surrounded by women who were caring for her and helping her. It was likely a big community event. The women would have been excited to help her. It would have been a joyous event. And it was a community thing. So instead of thinking of her as isolated, yes, she was very poor. It was not ideal. It was not where, you know, you would expect a king to be born. So that part of our tradition does seem very accurate. But the part where she's lonely, I think, is sadly mistaken. I think she was surrounded with community and that Christ was born into an excited group of people. The people were packed in there. It would have been a very exciting community event. And so I think that's important too, because when we think of how life should be, we are built to be in community. God has built something in us, in our deepest desires to connect to people, to be in relationship with other people. He's made us this way. And our society is so isolated, especially after 2020 and everything there. Things have gotten very, very isolated. And I think we all figured out really quickly how badly we need community, how badly we need community. We're not meant to walk alone. And so I just kind of want this to be a reminder of the importance of family, extended family, family you may not even know you have. And bring that into your spiritual family, the way you think of your spiritual family. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we're meant to be a family. We're meant to be a close-knit community that takes care of each other and loves each other and shows the world that we're different because we love each other so very much. Well, how can you do that if you're not in a community of believers? So I really encourage you this Christmas, if you are not part of a strong Bible-believing church, to find one and get involved, get to know people. I know Christians are human. They're sinners. We of all people should be the most humble because we recognize that we are not perfect, that we make mistakes. And so we should be the most humble community out there, and we should be the most loving community out there, rejoicing when people come in, welcoming. And so if you are part of a church community, remember that this time of year is when a lot of people go searching for that community. Bring them in, welcoming them hospitably, lovingly, humbly. Bring them in. You know, avoid, you know, big church words. Try not to be intimidating. Try to be loving and welcoming and just, you know, let them know how they can get involved and sit with them during the service and talk to them and get to know them. Really make an effort to bring our community together. This time of year is perfect for that. So I just encourage you to appreciate the community you have. Reach out and search for your spiritual community, your brothers and sisters in Christ, and welcome each other in this Christmas time with love and just joy and peace, that weird peace that can only be found in Christ. It's so strange how beautiful that piece can be. Okay, let me show you some quick resources if you're curious to learn more. Kenneth Bailey's Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes is fascinating, really good work. The Manger and the Inn, he wrote an article on the cultural background of Luke 2:7. That BibleArchaeology.org is a great website to dig through. Jürgen Bühler wrote an article called The Tower of the Flock. Gary Byers wrote Away in a Manger, but Not in a Barn. That was a really cool article. You can find that online. He was part of that Kerbet El Makatir archaeology, which I think is so cool. Tim Buck wrote about the Migdal Eder. Jim Cole Russ wrote People of the Little Town, talking about Bethlehem. Archaeology of the New Testament is fascinating. Ralph Gowers, The New Manners and Customs of Bible Times. Anything about customs. Customs and controversies, anything about, you know, the culture of the time is really helpful. Palestinian Dwellings by Yitzhar Hirschfeld was good. Christy McClellan, I love her. I love her. She just wrote, I've got the book by my bed right now. It's in the other room. Rediscovering Israel, she just came out with. Beautiful. Highly recommend that. Christy McClellan's Rediscovering Israel. Very well done. Promised Land Ministries, Archaeology of Family in Ancient Israel, The Ancient Caravanseries, Archaeological Ethnography, and then Ben Witherington III is great. He wrote The Birth of Jesus in this Dictionary of Jesus and the Gospels.
these big IVP dictionaries of Jesus and the Gospels are really helpful. And then New Testament history. So lots of resources. If you just look up, just make sure you're using good source material, that you're finding good, reliable sources when you're looking at this. Go for textbooks and bring them all together, because some people are convinced it was the Migdal Eder and some people are convinced it was the caves. And, you know, you just want to bring it all together, because we don't know for sure, but I think it's fascinating to look into. So I welcome you all to join me, come in to our lives on Thursday nights at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. We go live on this channel. And throughout the week, there's other videos. If you want to find all the live videos that we've done in the past, they're recorded under the live tab. And then other videos are under the podcast, or the playlist tab, or under the video tab. You can find lots of different subjects there. But we're going through Genesis right now. We're halfway through Genesis. It's a perfect time to join us on Thursday nights. So we'll start that back after the Christmas season. I'm doing specifically, you know, Christmas-related content right now. But after Christmas, we will come back and start going through Genesis again. I believe we'll start back on chapter 26. So we're right smack in the middle. It's a great time to catch up and jump in. But dig through some of our old videos, see what you like, and come join us on Thursday nights. And it was good to talk to you guys. I will catch you next time. Bye.